Good morning and welcome to Calvary Baptist Church this morning. Merry Christmas for one more time and Happy New Year for the first time. This is kind of our intermediate service between the Christmas season and the New Year. So we're going to open up with celebrating Jesus' birth one more time with the song, He Has Come For Us.
Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. He has come for us this Jesus. He's a hope for all mankind.
Calvary. So if you don't know me, my name is Ryan, and I have the pleasure this morning of conducting our morning announcements. I've only got three things for you guys today, but that's okay. The first thing I have is the baptism and membership signups. We've mentioned this the last couple of weeks. If you are interested in signing up for baptism or membership, we've got some clipboards up here in the front row you can sign up with. And also, if you want, you can talk to Pastor Joel. He'll be up at the front of the worship center. Secondly, in January, Calvary will be participating in a baby bottle change drive. There's not a lot of information about it right now, but just wait. Soon enough, we'll have more details about that. And lastly, the women's conference. We've talked about that the last couple of weeks. It is a two-day women's conference on February 7th and 8th. If you're interested in checking that out, there's a link in your bulletin if you want more details and stuff on that. And if you don't have any internet access to register for that, feel free to contact the church office, and they would be more than willing to help you out with that. So yeah, really short announcements today, but sorry about that. That's all I got for you. For now, we're going to go into our greeting time. So if you'd like, you can walk around the auditorium, say hello, and shake some hands.
As we continue our worship today, let's spend a few moments thinking about who Jesus was, the Son of God and Son of Man. And that's the point of the next song that we are going to sing.
In my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope in no place to begin. You made a way to let mercy come in. Arrested and my life
This week, I was kind of thinking along the lines of walking through Jesus' life. You know, we sang the first song that was about his birth, then we talked about and sang who he was, and that last song, what he did and what his death means for us. And that all leads up to this song, Lord, I Need You, because the reality is, you and I, we need Jesus every single day. And that's what this song, it's really a prayer of crying out to God, of for how much we need him. So much for coming, for being the Son of God and Son of Man, for coming and dying on the cross so that we could be saved from death, saved from sin. Thank you so much for saving me, for saving those in this building right now. And I pray for Pastor Joel today as he comes to preach his word, that you would give him clarity of thought and help him to communicate the word that he wants, or that you want him to communicate to us today. Thank you so much for saving us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Good to see you all. I wanted to just reiterate an announcement that's already been made, just as a reminder. If there is anyone here who is interested in joining our church as a member or being baptized, because you would need to be baptized by immersion here, unless you've been baptized by immersion somewhere else, you need that as well to become a member. If you're interested in either of those two things, just want to remind you to come down to the front here after we sing our last song and meet with me, and if you have any questions, I will answer them. I'll share about some dates and classes, and then you can officially get signed up for baptism and or membership. And just so you know, you are under no obligation at that point. By signing up, that doesn't mean that you are under obligation. But I do certainly hope that all of you have enjoyed your Christmas. I know many of you are like on a Christmas break right now, so I hope you're enjoying your vacation. And I want to say in advance that I hope you also have a wonderful and happy New Year as well. This past week has been about as crazy and has been about as packed as it could possibly be for our family. We did get to do a little bit of traveling to visit with some of Steph's family during this past week, and we got more coming up next week. We're going to be going to see my family. We haven't traveled out to see my parents since we've moved here, so we're excited about that. But I actually wanted to share about one time that we went to go and visit with Steph's mom and her family there. It was about 6 years ago, and it was at the time of Thanksgiving. And I had already learned by that point, in spending several Thanksgivings with the family, that they had this tradition at Thanksgiving time. And if I could give the tradition a title, it would probably be something like this. The tradition was, eat as much turkey as you can all day long. Like, that was the tradition. They would be cooking the turkey, and the turkey would come out, and we would actually start picking at the turkey a little bit and eating before we had our Thanksgiving dinner. And then we'd have the Thanksgiving dinner, and we ate a lot more turkey, right? And then the turkey would go in the refrigerator, and then this was kind of part of the tradition. People would just keep going back to the refrigerator and pulling out more pieces of turkey. But then there was another part of this tradition I got introduced to, which I had not done myself growing up, which was they were big on turkey sandwiches. So we would start making all these turkey sandwiches as well. It was pretty common Thanksgiving Day after we had the dinner, I would eat another turkey sandwich or two. We'd usually stay overnight into the next day, and so the next day we're eating more turkey sandwiches. And you know, they tell you that there's this stuff in turkey, this tryptophan, right? If you eat too much of that, you get tired. So I was getting sleepy. Now, there's some people, this new science that says it's not the turkey, it's actually the carbohydrates. You eat all those carbohydrates things, that's why you get sleepy. Well, guess what? If you're eating turkey sandwiches, you're getting both, right? I'm getting the tryptophan from the turkey, I'm getting the carbs from the bread. So come Thanksgiving time when I'm with Steph's mom, I'm in a food coma. Like, I am tired. But there was this one year we were there for Thanksgiving, and she wanted to take the family, this brand new movie that had come out 6 years ago. I don't know if some of you are familiar with this movie, what it was. It's called Frozen. Any of you heard of that movie? So this was the first Frozen, had just come out. And I remember thinking, I don't know if I want to go to this thing because I'm full, I'm tired, I don't think it's going to be that great of a movie. But we went and we saw Frozen. And I thought, that was okay. It wasn't bad. And then several months passed, and you know how like all these movies come out on DVD. So we got the DVD, and we saw it together as a family for a second time. And I remember thinking, hey, that was better than I remember. That was actually a pretty good movie. And there were some of these songs that I started getting stuck in my head. You guys remember, there's this one song. It seemed like everybody was singing it. It was on the radio. It was like people were singing it. It was on TV. You guys remember what that song was called? What that was? I'll give you a hint. I think it sounded something like this. Anybody hear that song? All right, that's enough of that. So, that's kind of how I felt when that song was being sung. It's like, that's all I'm hearing is this Let It Go song. And some of you who remember the movie, here was what was going on in the movie and why this girl Elsa sings this song, Let It Go. See, Elsa was supposed to be queen of her people, and they had this big ceremony, but Elsa had all this magic, and she couldn't control this magic, so she had this big problem. So if you saw the movie, Elsa runs away, and she just wants to let go of everything. She runs away from her kingdom, she runs away from her people, she runs away from her sister. She's trying to run away from everything, and she literally just wants to let everything go. She sets up this ice palace, and she's living all by herself out in the mountain. And I got to tell you, there have been some times in my life where I felt the same way. I've thought, I just want to let everything go. You know, I just want to go be a hermit somewhere in the mountains. But we can't do that. You know, that is not good. That is not healthy. That is not right. And I could share honestly, you know, for me over the last 2 years, these last 2 years were hard. These were tough years. There was a lot of tests. There was a lot of struggles. I'm very thankful that we have a new year coming. I'm looking forward to 2020. And I don't know what your 2019 was like. Maybe for some of you, 2019 was good. Maybe for some of you, 2019 was not so good. And I'm guessing for most of you, there are some things you are looking forward to just letting go of from this past year. And I'm thinking there's some of you that you're wanting to hold on to some things from this past year as you go into the next year. And that's what we're going to talk about this morning. This morning's going to be a little bit different. It's going to be a topical sermon. I usually like to teach verse by verse. There's going to be no main passage. We're going to be bouncing around a little bit this morning, looking at some multiple scriptures. But we're going to talk this morning about some things that we should let go of, that it's good to let go of, it's healthy to let go of, and how to do that the right way with integrity. But we're going to take a balanced approach because I also want to share with you this morning a couple things that you need to hold on to. You don't want to let go of everything. There are some things that have happened in this past year, and you need to take that with you into the next year because it's important with your relationship with Jesus as you walk with him, and it's very important for you as you continue to grow spiritually. So that's what we're going to talk about this morning. First scripture I'd like to look at, you could turn in your Bibles if you like. It'll also be on the screen as morning as well, as Romans chapter 8. We're going to look at verses 1 to 2. And I'm just going to keep moving here because we do have quite a bit to cover. So I'm going to go ahead and begin reading that there. Romans chapter 8, verses 1 and 2. It says, "Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death." Now, I don't want you to miss the point of this scripture, because the point of this scripture is very powerful, and it is also very freeing. And I'm going to read the point again. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. How much condemnation? None. No condemnation. Okay. I want to quiz you. Okay, let's see if we've been paying attention. So listen carefully. I'm going to quiz you here. If you are a believer, if you follow Jesus, and let's say you've messed up, let's say you've failed in some way, let's say in your past there's this sin, and if you are a believer, how much condemnation do you stand before God today with? None. I don't want you to miss that. I really want you to take that very seriously. And that is so important and leads us up to the first thing that we need to be letting go of from this past year, and it's this: paralyzing shame. Shame that paralyzes you, and often in connection to failure and not being able to let failure go. Look again at verse 1, because in verse 1 it says that there is how much condemnation? It says it's a two-letter word. No, that is an absolute. It doesn't say there is not much. It says there is no condemnation. There is none. Jesus does not condemn us for any reason as we follow him. And maybe there's someone who's here this morning and you've been beating yourself up from something that has happened this past year. You know, maybe you've been condemning yourself. And I'm not trying to say this in a way that's mean. I want you to hear my heart on this. But you got to stop doing that. You've got to stop beating yourself up for something like that, because Jesus does not condemn you, and you should not condemn yourself either. Now, as we look at this context here of these two verses, the immediate context has to do with sin. How, if we follow Jesus Christ, we are not condemned for the sin in our life. Now, as I've studied Scripture, I just don't see a God that enjoys just beating us up and trampling us and paralyzing us from past sin in our life. There's no question. We do experience guilt when we sin, and God does use that guilt. But you have to understand, God is good. And everything that God does is good. So the way he uses guilt is also in a good way. That guilt is used in a way to help us to turn from the sin that we are still dealing with. To turn from that sin that is acting like chains and shackling us. So yes, there is this idea that God does allow us to experience guilt, but that's why. God's intention is not after we've dealt with some sin or this past sin in our life, that we would just continue to feel this nonstop shame and we just feel like garbage for the rest of our lives. That's not in any way what God is doing if we are feeling that in our life. What is God's intention for you? Can we put that scripture back on the screen, Terry, in the back? What is God's intention for you? I want you to look again at Romans chapter 8, verse 1 and 2. Look especially at verse 2. I'm looking for a word. What is God's intention for you? He wants you to be what? Can anybody find that word? He wants you to be free. That's God's intention for us if we follow Jesus. He wants us to experience freedom, not a life of bondage. This isn't supposed to be a life of misery and grief of our old life. We're supposed to have new life in Jesus. He wants us to soar in Him. He wants us to thrive in Him. John chapter 10, verse 10, Jesus even says that. He says He came so that we could have life, but then He follows that up and He says, and life more abundantly. That's Jesus' intention for us, is to experience freedom. So I would encourage you, if you are dealing with some kind of a sin right now and you're stuck in that sin, you feel trapped. Maybe it's lust, or maybe it's greed or lying. If you are trapped by this sin, I would encourage you, seek help. Ask for God's help in that. Go and talk to a pastor. Go and talk to someone that you could trust, because God's desire for you is that you can move beyond that sin and you can experience greater freedom without that sin holding you back anymore. But if this is something from your past, if you're experiencing some kind of shame from something that's happened a while ago and it's been dealt with, and you still are feeling all of this shame, then you need to realize you have already been forgiven. God is not looking down on you, and you need to stop looking down on yourself too. Now, I will say there are times in our life we feel shame for things other than sin. Maybe this past year there's someone who feels shame because they made a bad choice. And it was a choice that wasn't sinful. It was just a bad choice, and you feel ashamed of that. Or maybe there's someone here you feel ashamed because you didn't complete a job well, or you didn't complete a job at all. Or maybe someone even feels ashamed because you forgot something. Maybe you forgot somebody's birthday. Maybe you forgot your anniversary. I can tell you I sort of forgot one of those this past year. In Christ, there's no condemnation for anything. And if we don't stand before Christ condemned because of our sin, then why should we stand condemned before Him for anything else as well? Here's the bottom line, and I really don't want you to miss this. If you believe that God condemns you for any past sin or a bad choice or leaving something incomplete or even just forgetting something, then you are underestimating the fullness of God's grace and forgiveness. You're underestimating that because you have been completely forgiven through Jesus Christ, and that's by His grace. So that's my prayer. I'm hoping that maybe there's even someone here this morning, as you are moving into 2020, this will be a great opportunity for you to let go of some shame that has been paralyzing you. And I realize it's easier to say that than to do that. It's not easy to let go of shame. That can take time. It can be a process. But you must begin with a willingness where you're saying, Jesus, I need your help. Will you help me, Lord, in removing the shame that's been paralyzing me from my life? God wants you to let go of that shame, and it's really something that you need to do. Now, here's another one I want to bring up, something else that we need to be wanting to let go of from this past year, and it's this: bitterness towards those who have wronged you. Bitterness towards those who have wronged you. And I want to deal with something right out of the gate with this, because just because we want to let go of bitterness towards someone, that doesn't mean that we should want to avoid that person in any opportunity we have, maybe to talk with that person and say, hey, can I share what I think you did and how that hurt me? If you get opportunity, you should sit down with that person. If someone has sinned against you, if someone has wronged you, you should be able to share with that person, if you can, here's what's on my heart, and here's how I'm feeling about that. Scripture even tells us that, and there's a broader context for this, but I think this certainly does apply when someone has wronged you, especially. Matthew 18:15, it says, "If your brother or sister sins," and this could be sin against you, go and point out their fault, just between the two of you. If they listen to you, you have won them over. Now I want you to notice the specific wording here. It does say brother or sister. Okay, this is a conversation specifically, probably be believer to believer. And there's a very logical reason for that. Because if there's two believers talking, that means they both believe in God, they both believe in his word. Generally, for the most part, they're going to agree on what the Bible says. Here's what's right, here's what's good. Now, it's good if you can talk to those who are not believers as well, but you just need to understand, if that person that you speak to does not believe in God or does not believe in the Bible, you may have very different conclusions as far as what's right and what's good. You understand what I'm saying? So just understand that. And I would even take it a step further. It doesn't matter if it's either. You might just know that person is just not going to listen to me. Doesn't mean you still shouldn't take that attempt, but you might just know that person is not going to listen. That person will not understand. So keep some of those things in mind. It might just be that person's stubborn, you know, and refuses to see your point of view. But still, this is what God's word tells us. If you can talk to that person, you should. Don't let this desire to let go of bitterness mean, I'm just going to ignore that person altogether. I don't ever want to talk to them again. No, that's not the right thing to do. But let's focus on the other side of the coin. This is really what I want to zone in on, and it's this. When people wrong us, it hurts. When someone does something to you, if they sin against you, as the Bible says, that hurts. And one of the hardest things to get rid of when we have been hurt or wounded deeply is bitterness against that person. That can be one of the most difficult things to get rid of, is how bitter you feel. How many of you have ever tasted something bitter before? Anybody remember tasting something bitter, maybe a bitter food or a bitter drink of some kind? I was even thinking, I'm not going to do this to you, but I was thinking of torturing you guys a little bit and having you all make your best bitter face. You know, we can all make our best bitter face together, whatever, when you tasted that thing, what did you do? And I've tasted some bitter things. One thing I can remember is coffee. You know, I've tasted some bitter coffee. And my palate is usually pretty forgiving. I love coffee. You know, I love all different flavors. I love bold roasts. I love light roasts. I love everything in the middle. But there's been some times I go to drink a cup of coffee, and it's too bitter even for me. You know, so if I'm setting that cup of coffee down because I'm saying it's too bitter, it's probably pretty bitter. But I remember that. I remember that taste. Now, I want you to keep in mind, what did that taste seem like? The intensity of the bitterness that your tongue experienced will never match the intensity of bitterness that you can feel in your heart when someone wrongs you. The bitterness in our heart is so much more potent, what we experience when people wrong us, and it just hurts. And here's the problem with bitterness. Bitterness can drive us to the point where we want to strike back. We want to retaliate. We want to do something that's foolish. Now, what does God's word teach us about how we should treat people who have wronged us? I got to be honest with you here. This is not easy. How God's word says that we should treat people who have even hurt us, have sinned against us, have wronged us. This is, to me, some of the most difficult stuff in the Bible to put into my life, to actually apply to my life. Let me share a couple scriptures with you. 1 Peter 3:9, it says, "Do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult. On the contrary, repay evil with blessing. Because to this you were called, so that you may inherit a blessing." That is really, really hard. When someone has hurt us so deeply and we're so wounded and we're bitter, and God is telling us, now go and bless that person. That is tough. And then Matthew 5:39-42 actually gives us, kind of fleshes out some practical ways that we should bless those who've hurt us. It says, verse 39, "But I tell you, do not resist an evil person." Then it continues. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other also. If anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. You know, I can think of two observations from these scriptures I've just read. Number one, as I read these scriptures, isn't that just a perfect picture of how Jesus lived his life? When you think about it, you know, we read about Jesus' life in the Gospels. That's what he did. People would hurt him. People would wrong him. He's blessing these people. Second observation is I can't think of things from the Bible that would be much more difficult than that for me to do. That is really hard. That is really hard. And I would even have this question. Can I really bless someone if I have a lot of bitterness toward that person? It's almost like, I feel like this is a Yoda moment or something, because bitterness leads to hatred, and hatred leads us to want to do something foolish and it's true. If we have this bitterness in our life, maybe your head's already spinning and you're saying, I hope the pastor's not going to ask that I just let that bitterness go. Because pastor, I've tried. I have tried to let that bitterness go. I've talked to counselors, I've read books, and I've tried to let that bitterness go, and I just can't. Can I tell you, I agree with you. I actually agree with you. I know what it's like to be hurt deeply. I've experienced that. And I've shared in this church before how as a child, I was severely, severely bullied. As an adult, I know what it's like to be misjudged. I know what it's like to be falsely accused. I know what it's like to be slandered. I know what it's like to have a friend that would abandon me in my greatest time of need, but yet that friend would be the first to point and accuse me in the face of false accusation. I know what it's like to feel that pain and feel that deep hurt. And there are times throughout my life I was at that same point. I'm like, I just can't let go of this bitterness. I can't just let it go, like Elsa sings about. And God has helped me a few times in my life to remember there's a better option. And if you are struggling today with some deep bitterness, there is a better, way more effective option for you than to just let that bitterness go. And it's this. God has taught me so many times in my life, I need to turn it over to him. I need to turn the bitterness over to him. I need to turn that person who hurt me over to him. I need to turn the situation that I was dealing with over to him. There's a huge difference between those two things. There's a difference if someone has wronged you to just let go of it, or to say, you know what, there is my God. And my God is righteous, and my God is just, and my God is perfect, and I'm going to turn everything over to him and trust him because he knows what to do with this. There is a huge difference between those two things. And so if you're experiencing bitterness right now, I want to encourage you to do the same thing, is to turn that over to God. Romans 12, 17 through 19. It's amazing how this starts out so similarly to 1 Peter 3:9, which we just read not too long ago. But it says, do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. But now look at this next verse. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath, for it is written, it is mine to avenge, I will repay, says the Lord. That's what God's word says. And if you turn things over to God, there's so many things that are encouraging to remember. Number one is God is going to see things from that situation that you probably missed. Whatever you've dealt with, God knows some truths that you probably missed out on. And if I can even be so bold as to suggest this possibility, maybe whatever situation you faced, maybe the person who was wrong was you. And maybe you just didn't see that. Maybe you just didn't realize that. But when you trust God with that also, no matter what, if it's you that's wrong or the other person, you can trust God with that situation because he knows all the truth and God knows what to do with that truth. And God is never wrong with truth. If God says this is what's true, he's never wrong about truth. He's never wrong about who was right and who was wrong or how the situation should have turned out. And God is never wrong in how to deal with that situation. God is never wrong. You can fully trust him. You can have 100% faith in him. And God is just. If someone has hurt you, if someone has wronged you, I don't want you to think that God's just going to ignore that. That God is not going to care, because he does care and he loves you, and you have to trust him, because if there's something there, God will deal with it. You know, I can tell you from my experience in those times where I've turned situations and people and that bitterness over to God, when I finally get to that point, because I'm stubborn, I am stubborn, you know, so many times I'm just going to deal with this, I'll try and get rid of my bitterness, and finally it's like a last resort, maybe I'll just give it to God. And then I'm reminded, I should have done that in the first place, is just give it to him. But when I turn those things over to God, I can tell you time after time, I start to feel relief. I can sense there's this burden being lifted off of my shoulders because I know God's got it. He is perfectly just, and he is going to do the right thing. So that's another thing I'm praying for, is maybe there's someone here as you go into the next year, if you've been holding bitterness in your heart towards someone, that you will be able to turn that person over to God, that situation over God, that bitterness over to him as you move on. Well, quickly, I'm going to actually address this in just a few minutes, but I want to talk about two things that are important to hold on to as we go into the next year. We don't want to just let go of everything. There are some important things that have happened in your life this past year that you want to take with you, and number one is life lessons. Life lessons. Yes, we should let go of our shame. Yes, we should let go of our bitterness. But that doesn't mean that we should let go of the lessons that we were learning from along the way in whatever we experienced. Now, if you struggled with some kind of sin this past year, or if you did make a big mistake, or if you did forget something really important, learn from that. Grow from that. Build off of that for next year. Or if someone hurt you, if someone slandered you, if someone misjudged you, if someone betrayed you, learn from that also. Grow from that. Build on that next year. But I want to give a caution as well, especially if we've been hurt. Because we might realize I need to make a change in my life. Here's the caution. Don't make a change based on your emotions. If you've been hurt or if you've made a mistake and you're like, I need to make some changes, don't just depend on your emotions to make those changes. Any changes we make in our life have to be through how God's word teaches us, because our pride and our pain can cloud our judgment, even when we're learning. And I believe the best way to learn is to do what? We have to humble ourselves as we read God's word, as we learn God's word, and as we apply it. God has sent a lot of people into my life that have acted as tutors, people that gave me advice. Times I've told people, you know, here's something I'm struggling with. Here's a problem. And I would often hear the same kind of phrase from so many of these people. They'd say, boy, I'll bet you there was a great life lesson in that. I hated hearing that. I just want to say, boy, I bet I just want to throttle you right now for telling me about this life lesson. I just want to rattle you right now. Because why can't you just tell me something more encouraging and something that I want to hear? But you know what? I never rattled any of those people because they were right. They were right. I can't change the things that I've done in the past. I can't change what people have done to me. But what I can do is I can learn from it, I can grow from it, and I can build on that for next year. One more thing I want to ask that you don't let go of as we go into this next year, and it's this. It's faith. Don't let go of your faith. I don't care what's happened to you. Don't let go of your faith in Jesus Christ. Don't let go of your faith in God. Because if you go into this next year without faith, you are going into this next year with nothing. To go into this next year without faith is like trying to go to some faraway destination, maybe like San Diego or something in California, and trying to get to that destination with no roadmap, with no directions, Because as we go into this next year, we need direction, and it's not from us, it's from God. God is the one that can direct you through this next year, and you need to have faith in Him. I don't know what your next year is going to be like. 2020 for you could be a good year. It might be a great year. Maybe 2020 is going to be a bad year. It might even be a terrible year. But you know what? No matter what is going to happen this next year, it's like I say when I officiate weddings. If there's sickness, if there's health, if there's plenty, if there's need, if there's joy, if there's sorrow, if there's better, if there's worse, whatever is going to come for this next year, God is with you and it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. And to know that God is with you as you go into this next year, no matter what it brings, that is called faith. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 6 to 10 says, "Therefore, we're always confident and know that as long as we're at home in the body, we're away from the Lord." Look at verse 7. We live by what? We live by faith. Every moment of every day. Not by sight. Not by, here's what looks like is coming up tomorrow. Here's what it looks like is going on in my life right now. No, we live by faith that I'm following God no matter what is happening. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So we make it our goal to what? What's our goal? What's our goal? To please Him. That should be our goal, whether we're at home in the body or away from it. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. So I want to encourage you, as you come into this next year, go forward in faith. Not faith in your circumstances, but go forward with faith in a God who is in control of everything. And as I close, I want to ask you this question. What will your goal be for next year? What's your goal? Is your goal for the next year to try and survive another year? Is your goal for next year to try and live off the satisfaction of all the good things that happen and just try and go from mountain peak to mountain peak, all those ups in life? Is that your goal? Or, because this changes everything, guys, is your goal for next year going to be, I want to live my life in a way that is pleasing to God? That is a totally different goal. And to be pleasing to God in good circumstances, in bad circumstances, when things are tough, when things are easy, even when there's pain, even when there's bitterness, even when there's guilt, even when there's shame, I want to live my life in a way that is pleasing to the Lord. We can't do that without faith. We must go forward in faith. I just want to make a final announcement before we pray here. Again, if you are interested in joining our church as a member or being baptized, as soon as we sing our last song, meet me down here. I'll go over everything with you. But at this time, let's pray. Jesus, we thank you so much for how you teach us every day, even though so many times we're stubborn, we don't want to learn. Many times we try and just teach ourselves and correct ourselves and do things ourselves. And Jesus, I'm just thankful personally for all those times you've taught me how that's so wrong. And I need to turn things over to you. And this is something I think, God, that we've heard about today from your word. As we've experienced shame in our life, as we've experienced times that we've been hurt, we need your help. We can't do this alone. And so, Father, in the way that we've seen from your word this morning, I pray that you'd help anyone who's dealing with that paralyzing shame, that they would be able to let that go and realize that they've already been forgiven in Jesus Christ, that they now have a new life and they're to live free and free from the shackles of sin, but also free from condemnation, even in the silly little mistakes that we do. And also, Lord, if there's someone who's hurt deeply because of how someone has wronged them, I pray, God, that you would help them understand how to turn all of that over to you and to trust you with that person, to trust you with that situation. Father, this is our desire. We've learned a lot this past year. Some of those lessons have been hard, have been painful. But we want to build off of that as you continue to grow us. We want to become more as we are disciples of you. We want you to continue to change us so we're more like Jesus. And we thank you. We can only do that in faith. Father, we thank you for all of this. It's in Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
If you are joining us today, thank you again for being here today. And if you are a guest, I would, at this time, encourage you to look in the seat in front of you. In the back of our chairs, we have this connection card. And I would encourage you to fill it out, put your name, address, whatever you want. This just gives us something to a way to connect with you and follow up with you. If you have prayer requests, you can also write them on there. I know Pastor Joel and Jason take time every week to go through and pray for that as well. And if you do choose to fill one of those out, you can pass it or put in the offering plates as they pass by. At this time, we are going to take up our offering, and this is a time that, as we sung about earlier, Jesus came to die and rescue us from our sin, and this is a way that we give back for what he has given us. If you would join me in praying. Dear God, thank you so much for coming, for saving us, for delivering us from our bitterness, and allowing us to have faith in you that can change our lives. And at this time, Father, as we give back to you in thankfulness for that, I pray that you would bless our gifts, that you would use them in a way that would profit your kingdom right here in Chenango County in Norwich. Thank you for giving us this opportunity to serve and worship you right here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lord is come.
thank you once again for joining us today. As you leave, one quick note. I encourage you to interact with each other one more time, fellowship with each other, and connect with each other. We are a family, and that's something that I know for me I want to work on in the next year. That's one of the life lessons that I've learned this past year. And so I encourage you to also interact with each other as you leave today. Thank you again for joining us today. Have a great week and Happy New Year.